Welcome, everyone, to The New Fly Fisher. I'm your host, Bill Spicer. This week, we're in beautiful southern Ontario, and we're going after smallmouth bass. First, we're going to be in a drift boat, drifting down the Saugeen River and trying for them with poppers. Then we're going to move over to Lake Huron and fish one of the many back bays you can find there and wade the flats. We're going to talk about lines, flies, rods, reels, everything. It's going to be a great show. Stay with us. We'll be right back.
The New Fly Fisher has been made possible thanks to GoFishInOntario.com, Able Reels, Ross Reels, Scientific Anglers, Orvis Sporting Traditions, Superfly, fly fishing for everyone.
Fly fishermen appear to be targeting smallmouth bass in greater numbers these days. This doesn't surprise me, as smallmouth are so much fun on a fly rod. If you've not tried fly fishing for smallmouth bass, you should. These hard-fighting fish are always a surprise. Landing a smallmouth bass is tough because they never give up. These brown bass are full of stamina and determination, probably more than any other species I've caught for their size. One of the best locations in southern Ontario to fly fish for smallmouth bass is the Saugeen River near the town of Walkerton. Walkerton is a drive-to location that's only 2 hours from Toronto and the U.S. border. Joining me today is Grindstone Outfitter owner and head guide, John Valk. John has guided on this river for many years, and with his vast knowledge and easygoing personality, I'm assured of a great day. Exploring Ontario's smallmouth bass opportunities need not be expensive. On this trip, I rented a nice, comfortable room at the Best Western in Walkerton. In addition to outstanding in-room amenities, the hotel property also features a heated indoor pool, a steam room and hot tub, a cutting-edge fitness facility, and is close to fabulous dining options. I also hired a guide. I recommend you hire a guide. It can mean the difference between success or not.
Come on, baby. There he is.
Good fish, too.
That is a good fish.
That guy come right up and nailed it. He come right out of the water. Oh, yeah.
Beautiful.
Oh, good fish, good fish, good fish. He's taking line. Look at that. Oh, yeah. That was a nice, nice fish.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Hate to repeat myself, Bill, but that's what brings the people here.
Yes, yes. Awesome. I love smallmouth on the fly. I just love it.
Especially on poppers.
Oh, yeah, especially you know, poppers. So visual.
Yeah, there is no take.
Yeah.
In fly fishing, like a bass on a popper.
That's right.
As far as I'm concerned, anyway. They're so explosive.
Come on, buddy. You're getting tired. I can feel it. On a 5-weight rod, too. That makes it doubly good.
He just wants to go home, Bill.
Yeah, he does. He'll be back there in a minute. But he ate that. There was serious hunger on that one. He's digging right in. Oh, okay, I think he's just about done.
Okay, slide him over. Yeah. Perfect.
Just good like man. That. Look at that.
Boy, that's, did he ever eat that popper?
He was. That was a hungry fish.
Okay. Now, Bill, Isn't that a beautiful soggy yeah. smallmouth?
That is just unbelievable.
Yeah. Nice unbelievable. Fish. Very nice fish.
That's probably an average fish.
Yeah, that's about an average. Yeah. You know, maybe a little bit better than average. Yeah, but
it's beautiful, beautiful
still
fish.
Still a gorgeous fish. But that fish, Bill, is 15 years old.
Yeah, yeah. And that's a shame yeah. about anybody that does take them out of here. No need to take them.
Well, a lot of people don't understand the age of these bass.
Yeah.
And, you know, once a fish hits 17 inches, they're up to about 20 years old.
Yeah.
And some of those 22, 23-inch fish that we get are over 25 years old.
Yes, and so, that's how long it takes to replace that fish.
You know, it shows the importance of conservation.
Yeah, right? Absolutely. Great, so, let's do that again.
Well done. Nice spot back in there.
God,
let's hit it again. You're going to find smallmouth in all areas of water where you have structure. The best thing for an angler is any point of rock, any log, any stump, a big boulder on the bottom, even just a current break or a current seam will hold bass. Don't forget, it's always all about food. So wherever the fish can lay, basically almost dormant during the daytime where it's just kicking back, and then move into an area to feed heavily, the main food sources for the bass, number one would be a big, something that's gonna give them a lot of protein, like a minnow, a leech, or especially in this river, the crayfish. Crayfish are really, really keyed in on here, and that's why these bass get so big in here. It's a lot of protein for them. The secondary food source would be the insect population. So we do have great mayfly hatches here, and those mayfly hatches and caddisfly hatches are a sustainable food source that are coming off the water at different levels 24 hours a day.
It's of utmost importance to cast very close to shore and to objects. Bass will hold in these positions, waiting for their next meal.
Got him. Yes, sir.
Good job. Oh, that's a nice fish,
Good
Bill.
Good fish. And he come out of the deep.
That was beautiful.
He come out of the deep. Gotta keep a tight line on him.
That was another good grab.
Yeah.
He came up a long way, didn't he?
Yes. Well, I started in shallow. And he ended up coming up in the deep, well, probably in the drop-off itself.
Yep. Well, it's a good spot right in there.
Yeah.
It's a really good food source, right?
Casting tight to the bank and trying to find structure.
It was such a nice take.
You like them ones. Get away from out there. Don't want them under the boat. Good size fish.
It is a good fish, yeah.
Good fish.
You love it when you get that nice, beautiful jump out of him right after.
Yeah, right away, as soon as he realizes he's hooked.
Yeah.
Beautiful.
There he
he's
is.
Not so long, but he's really chunky.
Oh, yeah.
Fat.
And hard fighting.
Yes. Look at that.
Isn't that gorgeous?
And look at where he took it again. Look at how far down this fish took it.
He ate that too, didn't he?
Yes, he did.
There we go. That's another nice smallie, Bill.
Yeah.
Beautiful, eh?
Excellent, excellent.
Isn't that great?
Yeah. Just excellent take was in the deeper water where it went from shallow to deep. That's where he was sitting.
There he goes.
And he come up from probably 4 or 5 feet. So, yeah.
Whoa. Well done, buddy.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you.
When you're fishing for these great smallmouth on the Saugeen River, I like to have two rods set up. The first rod would be a, you know, obviously a 5 or 6 weight. They're a great rod to fish for smallmouth bass on. Some of these bass are big. You might want to bring a 7, which is, that's also a good rod to do this with. But the 5s and 6 weights, nice rods, good action, nice rod to fight a fish with. And I like to load them with weight forward floating lines. And we can set up the popper rod with a very short, stout leader. So, you know, 8 foot, 8.5 foot, anywhere in that range. And you want it stout because you want to be able to turn over these poppers very easily. They are pretty wind resistant and you want to be able to punch them into the wind. For the streamer rod, again, a weight forward floating line, but we can set this up with a little bit longer leader. So, you know, 9 to 10 feet, about 8 pound test tippet, because some of these fish are pretty big in here. You want to have that strength to handle these fish and you're ready to go. Reels with good drags on them, you're all set for the big bass of the Saugeen.
Fish on.
Oh, good fish, Bill.
Oh, yeah.
That looks like a good one.
Yeah, it is a good one.
Here, I'm going to anchor you up here, okay?
Okay.
Good fish.
Yeah.
Oh, that's a real good fish.
Real nice fish.
Yep. Get him up. That's what you're here for.
Yes, sir. That's what the Saugeen River can produce. Big fish like this.
You got that on a popper, right?
A popper, yeah. And on probably the least expensive rod there is, this is a whole kit. It's a 9-foot, 5-weight rod, and it's got the line, backing, and everything. You sell them in your shop.
Yeah, well, that's it. You know, that rod's doing a good job, Bill.
Yeah, it's doing a great job.
Playing out that fish real nice.
Yeah. It shows you don't have to break the bank to get into fly fishing. This is a very nice fish.
That's a big smallie, buddy.
That's a nice fish.
That is a really good fish. He's gonna peel some line on you.
Yeah.
Well, now you're gonna find out how smooth that drag is.
Yeah. I'm gonna back it up a bit. Oh, no.
Oh,
no. Got into the current on me, and I lost him.
Popped out.
Popped out. Just pulled out of his mouth. Just pulled out of his mouth.
Well, it was on the black popper. That's right.
It's on the black popper, so I'll hold that up. That moves a lot of water. That popper itself, it moves a lot of water. Just cast along the edges of the shoreline here. They're not very far out. We've had quite a bit of rain, and what it does, it pushes the fish off to the side. Not too many in the middle.
Important when you're heading out for that bass trip, make sure you have a good fly box full of different poppers and streamers that you can use on that trip. I personally like to have a really good selection of different colored poppers. Dark poppers on those dark, dull days of fishing, that old rule of thumb of dark lure on a dark day, that really stands well with this. So some nice black poppers, dark brown colors, those all work on those darker, duller days. When you get into those bright days, you want that bright yellow and or the bright greens. White is a really good color. The other thing that we want to talk about is the burbling action of the popper. You can see this thing is really coned out well. This gives you a lot of noise when you're popping it through the river. Very important, because the fish will react differently on different days, especially water temperature and weather-related days. So a good selection of poppers, different sizes of poppers, different colors, very important. Make sure you have them all with you. For your streamer selection that you're gonna have in your box, minnow patterns are wonderful. They are in every body of water, and the fish will really key in on these. Anything that would imitate a leech, they're very handy to have as well. So basically what you're trying to do is match that natural forage, whether it's a minnow, a leech, a crayfish. There are really good crayfish patterns out there to have as well. The other thing you wanna do is make sure that you have some poly tips and or even some split shot to get some of these flies down deep in the really deep pools. You wanna be able to cover both the top of the water with your poppers and the bottom of the river with your streamers and your minnow patterns.
The next day, conditions had changed dramatically. Heavy rain in the morning had left us with cool conditions and rising waters. We would really have to work for our fish today.
Where did that come from? Where did that come from? We were going to move over to the other side of the river. And the popper was on there, and he just grabbed it.
It was only 10 feet from the boat.
10 feet from the boat, yeah.
That's a good fish. That's nice when you get the odd grab that you don't expect, though.
You don't expect it, but that's a good sign.
Yeah, it's a really
good
sign.
We've had a rain, and looks like they're hungry again.
Okay, we're going to let the boat float to land this guy now. Oh, that's a beautiful bass.
That's a good one. Really, look
that
at the markings
really
on him.
Really nice bass.
Bill, look at the markings on him.
That looks like about a four-pound bass.
Good.
Might even be 4+.
He's thick.
Yeah.
And strong, that's for sure. Thick and strong. And that was right in the middle of the river. I'm surprised at that. There must have been a rock underneath us for him to hide.
Or maybe he was just scouting and looking for food, because I think that's what... look at the
girth. Oh, my goodness,
of
look at this.
Bass. I mean... That is a huge bass, Bill.
Wow, look at this, John, my goodness.
That is a big bass. Well, you wanted a big one, Bill.
I wanted a big one, and this is everything I wanted.
For sure. Nicely hooked, too.
Look at that.
Just support his belly, okay?
Yep. Let's first off, let's get that out. Look at that, folks. I'm gonna put my arm up, and it is to the middle of my bicep, so that's, what would you say, 18, 19?
Yeah, oh, he's a 19-incher, for sure. Yeah, that's a beautiful
Lovely bass. Fish, lovely fish.
Yeah, just give him a little drink there for a minute.
Yeah, we'll hang him down here.
He's ready to go.
He's ready to go, and away you go, buddy.
We start in the spring every year with steelhead on the Saugeen River and other rivers as well. We'd like people, because that's a really busy time, we'd like people to book 6 months to a year in advance. But for the bass season, we're always available. You can basically call us 24 to 48 hours, and I have enough guides that we're able to look after everybody. We would appreciate about a month in advance. That would be fantastic. But we do have people who are traveling in here from all over the world to fish for these great bass. And like I said, we can get you looked after immediately.
The rain had negative impact on the river fishing, so John suggested we spend the evening on Lake Huron. Just like river fishing, lake fishing is all about structure.
John, could you explain to the audience why we're looking for structure such as rocks?
There's a couple of different things. Number one, obviously it's bright and sunny. So fish will like to sit in the shade, and the shade gives them a definite cover for like an ambush type point, right? Bait fish will move around the area, and that bait fish is going to travel in around those boulders and rocks. The other thing that you have, Bill, is a good concentration of crayfish. And where are crayfish? They're around every rock, every stone. So that gives the bass a really good opportunity to look for food there. And then, you know, there is a third thing here that we have, especially in the Great Lakes area. We have a huge hatch of mayflies here called hexagenia. And those hexagenia nymphs not only are in the silty areas, but every rock will create a small pocket of silt, okay? So those rocks will contain the nymphs for the hexagenia mayfly nymph. That's gonna actually, their hexagenia mayfly that's actually gonna hatch later on tonight.
Right.
Did you see that, Bill?
What's that?
That fish rolled just past where I dropped the fly.
I've seen two or three roll here, so
I think we've got him.
Got him?
Yeah,
good man.
He's on.
Excellent.
He rolled just past the fly. I dropped the fly. The fish rolled maybe 3 feet past it.
Excellent. So you put it right back there?
I just slowed down the strip a little bit.
Oh, and let him catch up.
And he just grabbed that fly and took off. That's a really nice fish.
That's a good fish. Yeah, John's putting on a clinic tonight.
He's got a lot of shoulders.
Good man. They're dark fish here, too, aren't they?
Well, some of them, you know. Some of them have that really light color to them, and then this guy looks like a darker pigment.
He's really dark. Yeah. Very good.
I think he wants to go into your boots for cover, Bill.
I think so, yeah.
It's another nice smallmouth, though.
Well, it's putting quite a bend in the rod, that's for sure.
Well, when you use 10-pound tippet, you can put a little...
You can put a little bend in the rod.
Put a little pressure on him.
Excellent. Actually, that's a nicer fish than the last one.
There we go. Look at that. That a pretty smallmouth. Look at that. Very nice fish.
Excellent.
Give him a little drink here. They're chunky fish, really.
Oh, yeah, look, it's got shoulders on it. Look how thick it is with from your fingers to your thumb and up. You got a big hand.
Thanks, Bill.
There were two setups we used on this episode. The first is a floating bass tapered line to a 9-foot leader tapered down to a 3X tippet and then the popper. For subsurface presentations, a clear intermediate line was used with a 4-foot section of 12-pound test monofilament as a leader, and then we attached the streamer.
My goodness, John. Oh, ho, ho! This is your night, isn't it?
This is a good fish, Bill.
My goodness, wow! Very good. Yeah,
oh,
that's a nice, nice fish.
That's a nice smallie.
Real thick fish. Oh, All right.
It's been a nice bend in that five weight.
Look at that, yeah. But it's a heck of a fish.
God, they're scrappy, I love it.
Oh, just scrappy as anything. Yeah.
Get a little jump out of them now and then.
Whoa. I'm looking into the sun now. All I'm seeing is a big dark shadow. Oh, John, this is definitely a good fish.
That's a nice fish.
Oh, yes. Oh,
that's
yes.
That's really nice smallmouth. All that little clouser, eh?
Yeah.
What a pretty fish.
Good fish. Very good fish.
Oop.
Well, that was excellent, excellent. Just going out here fan casting, trying to find structure. It's working, just putting a clouser minnow by there, trying to imitate what they're eating, and they're eating shiners out here. So that's definitely what we're doing.
Yeah, they are starting to turn over a little bit now too, Bill. We've seen a few fish start to come up on these spinners that are on the water.
Right.
So it's giving us a little more of an opportunity because now it gives you a target, right?
Right, right. I highly recommend anybody in the audience talk to John about guiding, whether it's on the Saugeen River or in the flats of Lake Huron. You're going to enjoy yourself. For more information on today's show and other shows in our series, visit us on the web at thenewflyfisher.com. From all of us here at The New Fly Fisher, thanks for joining us. Tight lines, and we'll see you next time.
The New Fly Fisher has been made possible thanks to GoFishInOntario.com, Able Reels, Ross Reels, Scientific Anglers, Orvis Sporting Traditions, Superfly, fly fishing for everyone.
To learn more about the New Fly Fisher, our locations, contests, news, and much more, come visit and like us on Facebook.